Hi, so in this video, I want to talk to you about the recent news that happened about the eviction moratorium and how it got suspended, actually extended until September 1st. So I'm talking to all the landlords in our network. So let me go ahead and get right to it. So this was the recent news that came out, and it came out about 10 days ago or so, but I've had a lot of questions about this situation. And so I figured I'd put together a video that hopefully gives you some insight and clarifies some things. So eviction foreclosure moratorium extended to September 1st. By the way, we're looking at floridarealtors.org. So it's a pretty official website. And that homeowners facing foreclosure and renters facing eviction cannot be removed until September 1st. So that's what I want to highlight and clarify. And it's that I've had several conversations with different property owners, landlords, where they have the property rented, the tenants, were affected by COVID-19, right? Or, maybe they weren't, but they stopped paying rent, right? Let's assume that everyone is honest, right? But they stopped paying rent. But as you can imagine, as a landlord, you become frustrated, right? Because they feel like their hands are tied. They have a mortgage payment due, they have an association payment due, they have an insurance payment due. And the tenant isn't paying rent and they feel like their hands are tied. They don't know what to do, right? They feel like, is the tenant going to stay here forever and I can't evict them? So what I want to clarify is that tenants cannot be removed until September 1st. That means the final step of the eviction process can't happen, which is basically the sheriff going to the property and physically removing the tenants, right? Let me show you what the steps to the eviction basically are, and I'll try to summarize them. And if you have questions about this or anything else afterwards, feel free to contact us and we're happy to clarify, all right? So this is basically the simple residential eviction process, right? So it always starts with the landlord and the tenant agreeing to a lease agreement, right? You sign a contract that they're gonna pay so much, per month for the next 12 months, and that's your lease agreement. But then the tenant fails to pay rent and the landlord decides to evict the tenant, right? Which might be you. Once you decide to evict the tenant, the first step is to post a 3-day notice. Basically, it says that the tenant needs to pay or vacate. Now, let me right here tell you that I highly, highly recommend that if you're going to start an eviction, go straight to a real estate attorney and let them handle it for you. I know it's going to cost you a little bit more money. Frankly, it's not going to be a whole lot more. Typically, a real estate attorney might charge a few hundred bucks for their services plus the court fees. And the court fees we can't get away from. That's just, whatever the court charges for the filing of that paperwork. And what the attorney actually charges you is just a few hundred bucks. So it's not worth it to try to save that money, because if you do an eviction incorrectly, best case scenario, you have to start from scratch. So you wasted time. Worst case scenario, potentially you could get sued for wrongful termination and it can just get complicated. The tenant can come back and file a claim against you for damages and harassment, and it's just not good. So the best thing that I can recommend is go straight to an attorney, tell them, listen, I have this property at 123 Main Street. I want to evict the tenant. They'll tell you exactly what you need. If you have any questions, contact me and I can kind of walk you through the process and we'll take it from there. But basically, the first step is you post a 3-day notice. Then the tenant must do one of these, which is basically pay in the court or vacate or do nothing, right? Some tenants do nothing, right? And if that happens, then the landlord, the next step, the attorney would tell you, listen, you would call the attorney and say, listen, the tenant, they didn't reply, they didn't pay, hasn't contacted me. What's the next step? The attorney is going to tell you, now we have to start the formal eviction process. And then basically you, through the attorney, will file the eviction paperwork, at the courthouse. Then the tenant is going to be served they're going to have a 5 business days to pay, no longer to you, but to pay the past due rent in the courthouse registry, right? In a cashier's check, and do that, or answer the summons, basically write a letter to the judge stating why they they shouldn't be evicted, why they think it's not fair, or some type of answer. After that, the tenant, if the tenant doesn't pay the rent to the court and a cashier's check and all that stuff, which they get very clear instructions, by the way, from the process server that goes to their house and knocks on the door and says, you know, hey, Mr. Tenant, you're being served with an eviction, right? Then eventually it ends up with a judge who reviews the case and either determines a final judgment in your favor, or it sets the court the case for hearing to see what the tenant has to say or not. But the only way that the tenant can get a hearing is if they pay the money to the court registry, because that's how it works. So anyway, this is basically what happens. At the end, after this, then what's a writ of possession is issued, and then that writ of possession is given to the sheriff, and the sheriff then goes and physically, you know, would call the landlord and will tell you, hey, listen, we're going to, you know, we're going to process this eviction. We're ready to do this eviction on Tuesday at 10 in the morning. Mr. Landlord, please be there with a locksmith, and we'll see you there. That final step is what's not happening right now. That eviction moratorium is suspending that final step. Let me show you another picture that I think you'll find helpful. Okay, so again, this is the Florida eviction timeline. So first, serve a 3-day notice, then file an eviction lawsuit. And as you can see, it takes some time. And in Florida right now, let's call it Miami-Dade County, Broward, it can take anywhere between 4, 6, 8 to 8 weeks for the whole process to go through, depending on the court and the judges, and you know, it varies. But the sooner you get started as a landlord, the better. So what is an issue right now, what is being suspended, is this issue of the writ of possession. The clerk of the court issues a writ of possession, and then the sheriff executes the writ of possession, right? So this is basically the order of removal, and then the sheriff goes and executes that order of removal of the tenants, right? That is what's being suspended right now. Let me show you another image. So this whole information, we're actually recently here, let me show you, on a call with, this is me, on a call with the attorney of the Miami Association of Realtors, an attorney from Legal Services of Greater Miami. And we're trying to, they were analyzing this whole situation, this whole process, what can or cannot be done. And again, you can contact an attorney about this, contact us for some clarification. But generally speaking, if there is no payment of rent and the tenant was adversely affected by COVID-19, if they were affected, then the landlord can file an eviction. It is okay to file an eviction to start the eviction process, right? That's what we're talking about, starting the eviction process. But at the end, the landlord might not get the writ of possession, but you can still file an eviction, right? If the tenant was not adversely affected by COVID-19 and they can prove it, right, then the tenant, then if they were not affected, but they still haven't paid, then the landlord can still file the eviction, and the landlord would be able to get the writ of possession, right? This is overly, obviously an oversimplification of what happens. But what I want to be, you know, make clear is that you as a landlord 100% can begin the eviction process. And what we're doing on our end, like even with some properties that we manage, is fortunately we haven't had too many situations like these with tenants, but with those tenants who can't pay, we're trying to educate them. Because what happens for many tenants is that they're simply misinformed. They think through either their own, you know, misinformation, or somebody told them, or somebody definitely misinformed them, or just by reading a headline like that one, right? You know, evictions suspended until September 1st. They don't quite understand what it means. Once you start an eviction process as a landlord, that will affect the tenant. That will be on the tenant's public record, and it will be on their record for 7 years. Actually, let me show you. And again, we had a similar video directed to tenants to help them understand this process, because I think that's really the biggest issue here, is people being informed and making the right decisions really for themselves. You know, quick Google search, how long does an eviction stay on your record? An eviction stays in your credit report for at least 7 years. Most more specifically stains on your public record. How would this affect a tenant going forward? Well, if a tenant, let's say, is in your property right now and is 2 or 3 months behind, eventually they're going to have to leave, right? Once they vacate, let's say, you know, 3 months into it, if you as a landlord started an eviction on them and eventually they're going to have to go move somewhere else, they're going to have to move into a rental community or rent a property through a realtor or even by owner, you know, a rental by owner, but maybe that particular property is a condo and it has an association and they do some type of tenant screening, which most communities do. They're going to check credit, criminal, eviction history. And then this eviction is going to show up on the record. And most property managers, an eviction is an automatic rejection, right? Most tenants don't understand that. So it's important. Let me also be clear that as a landlord, you know, let's be human, right? Let's be fair. But I want you to also keep in mind that you have options as a landlord, right? Don't feel like your hands are tied and that you can't do anything, right? You can have this conversation with your tenants. Again, you know, be decent, but explain to them that you can also try to reach some type of agreement and we can talk more about that. But understand that you do have some options and that if you do start an eviction, then it will affect the tenant's record and it will be on the record for the next 7 years. Also, let's say, for example, that you've had a tenant in your property and they've been there for 1 or 2 or 3, 4 months, right? Just because we've been through COVID-19 and maybe they legitimately lost their job, right? Doesn't mean that the rent disappears. That rent is still owed to you. As a matter of fact, let me show you real quick. Let me see if I can show you over here. This is the actual order. This is the actual executive order from the governor of Florida, right? Ron DeSantis. And this is the most recent one, right? Extending it through into September 1st. But down here, it says section 3, nothing in this executive order shall be construed as relieving an individual from his or her obligation to make mortgage payments or rent payments. All payments, including toll payments, are due when an individual is no longer adversely affected by the COVID-19 emergency. So we're trying to clarify this also for tenants to let them know that sometimes as a tenant, their best option is just to vacate and to vacate as soon as possible before the landlord starts an eviction, because once you start an eviction, it will affect the record. Whether or not there's a final judgment, it's irrelevant. It will already be on your record. It's kind of like if somebody gets arrested, right? Maybe you get arrested, but you don't get convicted. Well, that arrest is going to be on your record. And later when you go to look for a job, right? You know, they check your criminal history. Now you're going to have to explain what happened that you got arrested. Sure, maybe you didn't get convicted, but what happened that you got arrested? Same thing with an eviction. An eviction automatically is a red flag. And for most property managers, it's an automatic, you know, rejection. That's how it is. So anyway, hope you find this helpful. There's a lot of questions that, of course, can come up on this topic, and we try to make this video as summarized as possible. But if you have any questions about this or anything related, feel free to contact us. We're happy to put you in touch with a real estate attorney that who has helped us do evictions effectively, literally during COVID-19. We unfortunately had to do one. We finished it in March, late March, and so these evictions can still happen, and you do have options as a landlord. So anyway, again, I hope you find this helpful. Let me know if you have any questions, and we'll talk soon. Thanks.